Welcome to Crash Concepts, where the economy, energy, and the environment are explored. Up next, fresh ideas and insights into the factors that are driving the world and shaping your future. Presenting information you can't afford to live without, here's Chris Martinson.
Welcome to this Peak Prosperity Podcast. I am your host, Chris Martinson. Well, as of today, the world's central banks are out of fresh ideas, as if they had any to begin with. I mean, look, after 7 years of printing and mispricing money and fostering a massive surge in the levels of debt, all they've got to show for their efforts are low to non-existent to, in some cases, negative rates of economic growth and an enormous, largest ever wealth gap and some nice high equity prices. Hardly the sort of inspirational outcome they were really hoping for. So they keep doing more of the same, in the hope that it will all turn around soon enough. But what if their basic models are wrong? What if the core tenets of the economists running the monetary show are simply wrong? Well, they have all this wrong, then a very large financial catastrophe is not only a possible outcome, but I consider it a likely outcome, which means there's literally nothing quite as important to your financial future, or heck, your future in general, as understanding if the central banks have a snowball's chance in August of achieving their aims of delivering a smooth and prosperous future. Today's guest is the perfect individual to help us sort out what's going on and what the true risks really are in this story. Steve Keen is an Australian, an economist, an author. He considers himself a post-Keynesian, criticizing neoclassical economics as inconsistent, unscientific, and empirically unsupported. He is the author of the book Debunking Economics, an excellent book, by the way, and the popular blog debtdeflation.com. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you, Chris.
Well, it's really good to have you here, so let's dive right in. What have the mainstream economists got wrong?
Well, the thing which is very hard for people who haven't studied economics to actually get their head around is that mainstream economists developed reasons why they thought you could model capitalism without including the existence of banks, debt, or money. Now, I know that sounds like an outrageous statement, but in fact, if you go and search on Paul Krugman's blog, you'll see regular statements that you don't need to consider the banks or money or indeed private debt most of the time on the latter point. When you're modeling the economy, you can do perfectly well by ignoring them. Now, that is, to my way of thinking, a bit like saying you can be on the Serengeti plains and you can perfectly ignore the approaching herd of wildebeest. It's just beyond belief that they can start from that point of view, but that's where they actually start from. And that's the fundamental reason why they didn't see this crisis coming, why they had no idea why it happened, and why their attempts to cure it so far have been generally extremely unsuccessful, except for the capacity to inflate asset prices and caught a bit of a washover into the real economy, and why when they get back into trying to manage it again, when they think they're back to normal, they actually got themselves back to abnormal, but they don't know what abnormal is.
So wait, I need some help here because, Steve, this is it's inconceivable to me that you could just somehow think you can ignore debt in this story. I don't even understand that. So take their position.
Yeah.
How would they argue that you can safely ignore debt?
Well, they start from the simplest one they do it, and when they drum this into the heads of first-year students at university, is what they call the money illusion. And they tell students, well, here's a little model of how you behave involving what they call indifference curves and budget lines. Work out the consumption level, and then double all incomes and double all prices. What happens? And the student says, nothing, sir. And they then say, that's the point, you see. It's not the absolute level that prices and absolute level of money that matters. It's relative prices and relative, like they don't even talk about relative income, just relative prices are all that matter. And therefore, we can ignore money when we model how people behave at the micro level. That's stage one in the level of delusion they build up. Second level is that when they get to talking about the banking system at all, they develop a model they call loanable funds. And loanable funds, like everything else in economics, economic theory, tries to reduce economics to a pair of intersecting supply and demand curves. And on the demand curve, they talk about people's demand for money being sacrificing liquidity for yield. You know, if you have a high interest rate, you're willing to sacrifice liquidity and therefore not have money in liquid form. A low interest rate, you want to have a higher demand for money. Because in the downward sloping demand curve they like to have. Their supply curve, they effectively say supply is under the control of the central bank, but they add to that an argument that the extent to which people are willing to provide money depends upon the rate of return they get for it. So a high rate of interest, they're willing to supply more. In other words, they treat money just like the market for apples, like the market for printers, like the market for cars, et cetera, et cetera. So it's no different to any other market. And when it comes to explaining why this has no effect at the macro level, the implication of loanable funds is that loanable funds involves Chris Martinson lending to Steve King. It doesn't involve the Bank of Martinson, the Martinson Bank lending to Steve Keen, the individual. And they then say that, well, if Chris Martinson lends to Steve Keen, Chris has to allocate some money he was going to spend to a flow of money to lend to Steve. Therefore, Chris's spending falls by the amount of the flow that he's lending to Steve. Whereas Steve can go out and shop with the money that Chris is lending him, with, of course, an interest rate bill coming along as well. With that flow of money, Steve managed to spend more. So Chris spends, as the lender, spends less. Steve, as the lender, spends more. The two pretty much cancel themselves out, unless I'm much more of a spendthrift than you, which, by the way, I probably am. And therefore, it's a second-order effect. You can ignore it at the first-order level. Now, that completely ignores the fact that when you lend me money, you don't create any money. But if a bank lends me money, it does create money. Right. And this complete creation process of money lending is ignored and derided and satirized and ridiculed by the mainstream, which has people like myself pulling my hair out in exasperation. And finally, the Bank of England joined me in exasperation and published a beautiful little paper in the beginning of last year called Money Creation in the Modern Economy, and pointed out that when an individual lends to another individual, there's no net money creation, and there is an offsetting decrease in demand by the lender, increase in demand by the borrower. But when you look at it from the bank's point of view, when a bank makes a loan to an individual, it records an additional asset of its for its own, the loan, and it in, which means its assets rise and its liabilities rise, which is its deposits. It adds, puts money in the person's account. The money then, the person then spends that money, and you therefore get a generation of demand out of the creation of debt. Now, that is that's the analysis that I take. It's the analysis the Bank of England is onto. The Federal Reserve is still off on cloud cuckoo land, believing the stuff that Krugman spouts in his column in the New York Times. And consequently, they ignore the role of the creation of money by banks as a creation of demand, and equally importantly, when debt is paid down, when people deleverage, as they did during the financial crisis, that deleveraging is a destruction of demand. So they're ignoring the major factor that's causing the ups and downs of the global economy.
So is this what you meant when you wrote recently, you said you shouldn't just ignore what you cannot explain? It feels to me like the central banks, at least the Federal Reserve, they're ignoring this debt function.
They're completely ignoring it. And it's what is actually beautifully described by Kahneman in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, as theory-induced blindness. Because it's very, as you said for yourself, it's very hard for you to even imagine people are trying to model the economy without including banks, debt, and money in it. But they have this theory-induced blindness that said banks, debt, and money don't matter. So they don't even look at the data to begin with. And then when you show the data to them, their theory gets in the way of them even perceiving it. And they say, oh, well, I want to see, you just got correlation there. What's the causation? Or I want to see panel data rather than just one country. And I show them 20 countries and they get the same response. And they continue ignoring it. So it is just a blindness to the whole issue.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I read that same paper you did when the Bank of England came out. And I was shocked for two reasons. One, that it took them that long to figure that out. And I think they also kind of concluded that bank reserves are not essential to the whole process of loaning, that in fact loans mm-hmm. comes first, and the bank will make a loan if it's got a good loan. It'll find the reserves later if it needs to.
Yeah.
And so they'd figured that part out too. But I'd been reading, for over a decade, you know, when I became aware of it, but I can find books that go back a very long ways that understand the money creation mechanism and its role on demand.
Yeah, I mean, you go back to before the 1930s, you find that it was commonplace to understand this. It's really just a recent fetish coming out of the American mainstream economists, largely beginning with Tobin back in the 1950s. Tobin himself actually effectively ended up disowning the concept that he helped to bring in, that banks didn't matter. In his later work, he became a good friend of Stephanie Kelton, who's one of the leading thinkers in endogenous money these days, and now thankfully working in the United States, I think, Congress office as an advisor. So her intelligence is turning up in the Congress. But this belief that banks, debt, money don't matter to macroeconomics really was a fetish of what I call the Samuelsonian approach to economics, which evolved in America, called itself Keynesian, but had bugger all to do with Keynes. And the more extreme right-wing version of that being what Milton Friedman and co. Developed and gave rise to what they now call neoclassical economics. They're even more strident at ignoring the role of virtually everything apart from indifference curves, and which are fictitious, and marginal cost curves, which are actually fictitious. So it's an American thing. And it's not just the intriguing thing is, if you look back in the 1930s and so on, before the 1930s, it wasn't just progressive economists like it is today who make this case. It was quite conservative economists who also saw it. So, for example, if you read the general theory, you'll find Keynes counterposing his views to Pigou and seeing Pigou as being the expression of the conservatives. Pigou had a book called Industrial Fluctuations, written, I think, in 1927, where he correlated the change in level of private debt to the rate of unemployment, and made the case that the change in debt generated demand, and this is a major part of why there was a correlation between it and the level of unemployment. So even somebody that Keynes regarded his conservative foil in the pre-Second World War period understood the role of banks, debt, and money in the economy. It's been obliterated from the textbooks, but of course it hasn't been obliterated from reality, which is why we had the financial crisis.
So let's talk about one last piece of economic so-called reality. Behavioral economics tells us that people are irrational, right? Predictably so. And you and I already know that because we interact with people and we're humans, and so we understand that. But classical economics still assumes people are rational. Again, this is a bad assumption, correct?
Well, I think you're actually doing them a favor by calling what they describe as behavior as rational, because it's not what they describe as rational behavior is not rational at all. It's prophetic. Their definition of rational is that someone has a model which can help them accurately predict the future. And if you walk into the street and ask them to say, I have someone who has a model that can predict the future, how would you describe that person? And the person you say, oh, you mean Nostradamus or Jesus? Or do you mean, a prophet? And say, oh, no, I mean you. You're a rational person. Therefore, you have a model that helps you predict the future accurately. They'd lock you up. Now, that's what they actually developed as a definition of rational. And the reason that happened, when you look in the development of history of economic thought over time, is in some ways it was an inevitable necessity for them to reach this absurd position, because they tried to argue that you could work out the economy without considering people's expectations of the future. When you read Keynes, again, he said he accuses classical economic theory of being one of those pretty polite techniques suitable for a well-paneled ballroom in stable conditions, which tries to deal with the present by abstracting from the fact that we know very little about the future, which was an accurate characterization of the mainstream economics at the time Keynes wrote. But what they've tried to do by supplanting Keynes is, rather than saying let's ignore the future, the only way they can tame the impact of the uncertainty of the future on the decisions we make today is to presume we can accurately predict the future. So falling for this nonsense of rational expectations was a necessary consequence of trying to build an equilibrium model of the economy. And that's where they've ended up. And interestingly enough, there's a paper by one of the leading apparatchiks in this whole area called Robert Barrow. And Robert Barrow wrote a paper in 1984, I think, called The State of Rational Expectations in 1984. And he wrote in the opening of the paper that one of the cleverest things about the rational expectations revolution, as they describe it, was the, and one, this is a direct quote, the appropriation of the word rational. He said, by which case it meant that anybody who wanted to oppose them had to either support irrational behavior or talk about deviation from rationality, which is a very difficult thing for an economist to do. So he's actually admitting they stole the word from the dictionary. That's what appropriation means. So I'm appropriating it back, and I now describe what they call as rational expectations as prophetic expectations. And that's what they use in their models to cancel out any uncertainty about the future, any capacity for state actions to affect the level of the economy, and also any capacity for crises to happen. Because if you could predict the future, of course, you'd never walk into a crisis, would you?
No. So if I add this all up, by failing fundamentally to account for the proper role of debt in the economy and demand and the way it pulls demand forward from the future into the present, appropriating the word rational and misusing it badly in models, this whole idea that we have some form of equilibrium economics as if it was a closed form equation where if we just dialed everything right, we could have this perfect steady state of full employment, full capacity, all that. So given all those things, if you put them in a spot, it says they've got a bad model. Steve, what's the risk of having bad models at the heart of your monetary policies?
Well, certainly you're going to run into a wall you don't even see coming your way. And this is what, of course, happened in the financial crisis. And if you look at the conventional literature, they simply can't explain where it came from apart from saying it was due to a big exogenous shock. Now, I don't know whether you noticed it. I didn't see any meteor landing next to my city. Did one hit yours? You know, exogenous shock means something from outside the planet, pretty much, outside the economy. There's a paper by, what's his name, Ireland. Think of the country Ireland, talking about the failure to anticipate the crisis during 2010, running during 2010, and he wrote that saying that the failure to anticipate the crisis makes you think maybe we should revise our whole economic theory approach. But he then said, now if you take a look at it, we can find that the reason the crisis happened in 2007 is that the economy is hit by a set of exogenous shocks to technology and preferences, which are the two categories they talk about. Technology for firms and preferences for consumers, of roughly the same scale and size as that in previous downturns, but they then got bigger and lasted longer. And therefore, we can explain the crisis because there were shocks to technology and preferences. Well, what were they, mate? You know, what? Identify them, please. You know, what happened? Did consumers suddenly stop disliking Coca-Cola? Was there a wave of people buying fresh water rather than Pepsi? What's going on there that explains this huge movement? And of course, they can't do it. So they bring everything down to exogenous shocks. And of course, the real world would be an exogenous shock if you leave it out of your model. And fundamentally, what they've done is by leaving out the banking sector, any crises that emanate from the financial system will be a surprise to their models. Now, they're bringing in, ever since the crisis hit, they decided they needed to include the financial system in their source of things that impede the perfect market from reaching a perfect equilibrium. But as usual, and you'd know this well, they incorporate it as they incorporate everything else, saying the financial sector is now a source of additional frictions. Now, of course, friction is something that slows you down. If you believe the system is going to converge to an equilibrium, then the friction will mean you get to equilibrium more slowly. It doesn't explain acceleration and why you suddenly fly off rapidly and have a crisis. So they can explain why once a shock hits, the financial sector means you take longer to get back to equilibrium, but it doesn't explain the financial sector as a source of accelerants that cause a crisis in the first place.
It all sounds so self-serving because, you know, one of the things that the central banks really want to do is to, at least from my perspective, is to enable sovereign entities to deficit spend. And so they need a large and willing pool of people who are willing to absorb that debt. And if those don't exist, they will themselves become that willing pool. It feels to me like the whole thing is a bit self-serving because...
No, it's not. I'm going to disagree with you. That is, in fact, these same economists who developed this fantasy, one thing they want to justify a role for the central bank in setting the reserve interest rate. So that's a major part of their models. So they want to justify the status and importance of the central bank as a setter of the price of money. That's what they want to do. In terms of the volume of loans being generated by the government, they are actually in favor of 100% if the government runs a deficit, they're in favor of that entirely being financed by selling bonds to the public. And they would prefer to see the government running a surplus, not having a deficit at all. So you're seeing, I can understand where you get that position from, but the fundamental nature of their thinking is that the economy is best if the government is a size zero. That's the extreme neoclassical. Of course, people like Krugman don't believe that, and that's something in his favor. But the extreme neoclassicals actually believe that you should get the government down to virtually not existing at all. They believe the private sector works perfectly well without any government intervention whatsoever. And when you look at the horror that's being imposed on Europe right now, the fact that there is a fetish running government surpluses over here is another product of the economic theory.
Well, so let me tell you where I get this view, and my view stems from this. Now, you've shown before that it's technically possible for a debt-based money system to operate in a non-exponential fashion, but all the real-world data I have, Steve, shows near-perfect exponential behaviors, R-squareds of 0.99, right? This is both for debt and monetary aggregates individually.
Yeah.
So I see a big problem with having an exponential money system on a finite planet. That's the core of my view. But mainstream economists, I think what I'm seeing from the central banks is that I feel, this is my perception, that they have got us on an exponential debt train, and they need to continue that. And whether that continues in the public or the private sphere is a little bit irrelevant. I agree with you. They would prefer it to happen in the private sphere. But if it's not happening there, perfectly happy to continue that train in the public sphere, if necessary, maybe under exigent circumstances. How do you respond?
You're wrong about their ideology and why they're doing it. They don't even know that that's the case. They don't think there is any particular trend. And they're actually, their preferred situation would be to drive public debt down relative towards zero. And they ignore private debt completely. So you're gracing them with too much comprehension of the world in which they live. There's a wonderful sci-fi book I read a while ago called The Wind-Up Girl, and it had a wonderful line in it where the protagonist, who was not at all a likable person, was described as suddenly realizing that the world he understood was not actually the one in which he lived.
Right. I regularly give people too much credit, and so if I look at what I thought for sure, somebody in the Federal Reserve would have been following the same data I was, which is starting in 1970 in the United States, total credit market debt has been compounding at nearly 8% per annum, 7.9%. And income, GDP, GNI, whatever we want to measure, has been at roughly half that rate. So, you know, to me, it looks like since 1970, there's been a very concerted effort to have credit and credit markets expanding at roughly twice the rate of the underlying income growth. To me, that's just a math problem waiting to happen. Are you telling me that in the Federal Reserve, there's nobody who looks at that and says, sooner or later, that just breaks?
Yep. Nobody looks at it in the Federal Reserve.
Really? That's disappointing.
Mate, it's even more fresh. I deal with these people on a daily basis. And to give you an idea of how primitive the thinking is there, this is not the Federal Reserve. This is the Australian Central Bank, the RBA. But I was once at a speech by one of the deputy governors there, and he and I had a chat after the whole thing, and I was talking about the problems of the debt to GDP ratio, the private debt to GDP ratio. He quite literally said to me, "I don't know why you worry about that, because you're preparing a stock to a flow." As if I was making a stock flow error. Now, stock flow error is you being a properly trained scientist and engineer, you know that the stock flow comparison is adding a stock to a flow and thinking you've got a meaningful amount, unless you're indeed not looking at the rate of change. So you make some mistake between us. You know, people often think interest can't be paid, and they're comparing the loan doesn't create the interest, and they say that there's the, you should be given the interest for the loan as well as getting the loan. What they're doing is they're looking at dollars and dollars per unit of time and not realizing they can't combine the two that way. But to make a comparison of stock to a flow, to get a ratio like you and I are working on in terms of the debt to GDP ratio, makes eminent sense, because the ratio tells you how many years it'll take to repay the debt you're in. So that's a level of stupidity. And it's not that the guy's stupid at all. It's that they simply have a mental framework that doesn't allow them to consider that issue, so they will come up with nonsense reasons why not to think about it.
So let's talk about this $200 trillion of debt. I'm sure you saw that McKinsey study. World has got saddled with that monster amount. Can that ever be paid back?
And no.
So, no? Okay. What terms is it going to get dismantled then?
Well, we should be writing off large parts of it, and I would actually write it off by the capacity of the government to create debt-free money. That's, and I'll be using what I call a modern debt jubilee. So it'd be quite feasible to do that on a grand scale and change the basis, the effective basis of a large part of our money supply from credit-based to fiat-based. So it's quite feasible to do it that way. But what we won't do it that way, of course. What we'll do is let people go bankrupt and hound people who can't pay their debts, et cetera, et cetera, and force them to pay debts which are unsustainable, like's happening in Greece right now. And what that will mean is that rather than people being able to spend money, they'll be forever paying off their debt with whatever income stream they have. And by doing it, we'll depress demand in the economy so that as well as paying down their debt, they also reduce the size of the GDP and the ratio imbalance remains much the same. Of course, that's the situation I've described. It's been the situation of Japan for the last 25 years. So this sort of madness can go on for a quarter of a century. And the only salve to it, and the reason that Japan's got away with it successfully so far, there's two salves. One is the government running a deficit and running up its own debt. The government's the only organization has its own bank, effectively. So that's the reason the government can get away with running their debt. So government debt in Japan has gone from, I think when the crisis began in 1990, 75% of GDP to 250%. And that's provided a stimulus the economy wouldn't have had without that incredible increase in government debt. At the same time, Japan runs a huge trade surplus that also lets it get away with it for a large length of time. Globally, of course, there's no such thing as a global trade surplus, so that particular avenue goes. The only solution to the level of private debt we're in and the drag that's putting on the global economy is to have a huge amount of government spending. But of course, with governments trying to rein in their own deficits as well, we get caught in a stalemate. And so the likely outcome of all this is stagnation with levels of debt that remain constant while GDP falls.
And that sounds like a recipe for having an ever increasing proportional flow of what real income and productivity is occurring from the general populace to the holders of that debt.
Yeah, yeah.
And so in the context of this wealth gap that we've got right now, which, by the way, I think is a bit false because it's obviously been pumped up to some extent by the QE and other printing efforts of the central banks. But eventually, just mathematically, it sounds like if you play this debt game long enough and you don't have some sort of rebalancing, there, you know, if you're over expressing debt relative to income, sooner or later, even if you have, unless interest rates go to pure zero, if there's any nominal rate of interest at all, what you're going to find eventually is that 100% of your income ends up being consumed by debt payments somewhere. Not now, but you know, some at some point. Is that right?
Well, that's the eventual alternative. You don't need to get 100% by any means. You simply have to get to the stage where you can't stay alive and pay your debt at the same time. So because if you don't make your debt payments, and let's say you're talking people in a mortgage, of course, then the house gets repossessed. Now, that means that the pressure is on you unless you can walk away as Americans did given the legal system there with you know, jingle mail. It gives you an inability to consume on other things. And so it's just the gap, it's the gap between what you're getting as an income and what is the absolute necessary level of spending to maintain your minimum lifestyle. And if that gap falls to zero, then given interest payments, then you know the whole thing collapses because suddenly people go bankrupt, and then that just cascades through all their other spending, and they go from being at a desirable level of disposable income to being wiped out. And that's we're so close to that level at all times now because so little deleveraging occurred during the crisis itself. So little deleveraging is possible.
Right. Right. Well, let me back it out really wide for just one second, then I'm going to close in on Greece. So here's how I back it out really wide. So I'm looking at things like the Social Security and entitlement shortfalls in the United States. And of course, this is a net present value calculation. All future flows and outflows, inflows and outflows are balanced. And then you get a number, right? And so when I go over to the Congressional Budget Office and I look at their projections for inflows, I see that they just smoothly give about a 3.3% rate of GDP growth for the United States for the next 100 years, right? Yeah. And so, of course, this is exponential growth. You model it out, you discover that by the year 2076, the United States alone, in current dollar terms, has a GDP as large as the entire world today, right? So given where we are with respect to oil, other resources, water, soil, things like that, I find it hard to intuitively, in fact, I will reject this intuitively, that the idea that the United States will alone have an economy consuming as much as 100% of the world today by 2076. It feels to me like there's something in there that just doesn't work in this story.
More than something. I mean, this is, again, the whole awareness of the extent to which an economy is based upon the exploitation of free energy and the necessity that that generates of generating entropic waste, both in terms of heat, but also in terms of when you're processing minerals, actual physical waste, and then the impact that it has upon a biosphere of a limited scale. All that thinking has been completely excluded from economics because they've never, ever developed a fair way of system thinking. They think in equilibrium terms. So they project forward 3% growth per annum indefinitely without thinking, well, what is the systemic impact upon that, given the scale of the planet we're on, given the amount of capacity of the biosphere to absorb that waste heat, et cetera, et cetera. I don't know, you probably have seen it, Chris. There's a wonderful article called, I think it's called Exponential Economist Meets Finite Physicist. Have you ever seen that?
Oh, yeah, by Tim... Mr. Brown.
Yeah. Right. Now, what that argues, of course, is that even if you leave out global warming, so for any of those global, if you have, I don't think you would have any global warming deniers on your reading list, but even if you did, you could even say, even ignoring the complete existence of global warming, if we can carry that forward, the current rate of per capita growth in global GDP, pardon me, and you emphasize per capita to get away from population growth as well. So that even if we stabilized population, but had the same per capita rate of growth we're talking about now. I think in something like about 250 years' time, the through that entropic waste, you know, the entropy generated by the production process.
Just waste heat.
Simple waste heat. The temperature level of the planet would be hot enough to make water evaporate. So we join Mars at that stage. And if you kept it going for, I think, 450 years, the one lovely effect of the exponential function, by that stage, the surface temperature of the Earth would be equivalent to the surface temperature of the Sun.
So you think we might stop somewhere before then?
We might stop somewhere before that. So this inability to bring this into economic thinking is one of the many, many flaws. So I'm actually working with Bob Ayers and a few other people who are, you know, energy-aware physicists working in economics, trying to bring energy into the production equations that economists use because they completely leave them out. They have equations that presume you can produce output using capital and labor, where energy is not included as a factor.
I'm so glad to hear that that's happening because it's by far the largest gaping hole in all of this for me, which, you know, and by the way, you know, I get all the time, people send me emails like when Ray Kurzweil says, oh, the world's going to be 100% on solar in 16 years because he's just sort of taken some simple doublings and penciled them out. Mm. And, you know, I was just in Mexico City and the place is just one giant traffic jam and it's not unique. I was in Lima a while before that, same thing. It doesn't matter which city I go to, I see humans burning oil at just this phenomenal pace. Mm. And there's no way we're going to replace any of that traffic with solar powered cars at any point soon, not on a percentage basis. And yet, you know, the United States is going to peak in shale oil output in the year 2020 at the latest. I think it'll be sooner given the hiccups they've had there with the pricing. And that's, to me, like right around the corner. And yet, you know, you have people buying Spanish 50-year bonds at whatever that went off at, you know, 3% or something. Tell me, in the world of finance, who's buying a 50-year bond and can they not connect dot A to dot B in the story?
Oh, again, it's that inability to think in the long term. So this is one of the great weaknesses of conventional economic thinking, again, because people think in equilibrium terms, and static equilibrium. They call it dynamic in they call dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models, but they're not dynamic in any genuine sense of the word. They don't extrapolate. They don't then look at the long distance extrapolation and say, well, this obviously can't be maintained forever, so we have to have a feedback that reduces that rate of growth or causes something else to change. They don't have that. So the complete lack of system thinking is then captured by them when they're going to get a job in the finance sector. They work on a 3-month quarterly basis. And the basic answer to you on that question is, I know if I can use French in your program, mate, I couldn't give a shit about what's going to happen in 50 years' time. I'm looking for my bonus in 3 months. And if that the price of Spanish bonds is rising, I think I can make a play on them. I'll buy them.
Well, certainly seems as short-sighted as I thought it might be. So let's turn to Greece for a second. You're friends with Yanis Varoufakis, Greece's new finance minister. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How long have you known him?
Oh, I met Yanis in 1989, so quite some time ago.
Great. Well, what's he like?
He's a great bloke. The funny thing about Yanis is that you don't need to ask me, you can watch TV.
Yeah.
In other words, what I'm saying is the personality you see on TV is precisely what he's like in private. He's a wonderful orator. He's very magnanimous. He has a beautiful voice and just fills the room with his voice. He's every bit as big as he looks in terms of physical physique. He works out more than I do, and certainly more than most economists do. Very warm, plenty of bonhomie, and highly critical of mainstream economics and well-trained in mathematics. So that's what made us good friends when we first met, because most critics of mainstream economics criticize mathematics and the mistaken belief that it's mathematics that led economics astray. I describe what economists call mathematics as mythematics. and Yanis is one with me on that front. He regards their math as delusional. And he actually did a master's in mathematical statistics before he ended up doing his PhD in economics. And so he's highly enough trained in mathematics to know what the economists do is trite or garbage or wrong. And he's been pushing that line for many, many years in economics and the way he teaches and the work he did in game theory and so on. So the general thing of it, he's a very, very warm and a large personality guy. Give you an idea of the last thing that happened, like, and I can give a element of that too. You know, my university in Sydney shut my department down, University of Western Sydney. I got an invite out of the blue to Western Sydney function. Gave me a surprise. I opened it up and saw why Yanis Varoufakis was talking at a conference. He insisted he was not going to give the talk unless I was in the audience. So I got invited. Now, that's both balls and respect for a friend and integrity. And so I have a really feel for him in this position, because when he got offered the position of finance minister, and when the Syriza won the election, he said, thank you, I'm delighted to receive this poison chalice.
He knew what he was getting into, didn't he?
He knew what he was getting into, but I think it's even worse than he thought, because, I mean, for example, I made a couple of suggestions about macroeconomic arguments he could make with the other finance ministers. He said, if only they were interested in macroeconomics. He said he can't even get them to discuss macroeconomics, and yet they're making decisions about the macroeconomic fate of Greece, of Europe in general, not just Greece.
Well, of course, you describe somebody who's genuine, authentic, and full of integrity. I notice that the bureaucrats in the EU have not taken to him all that well, perhaps because of those same descriptors we just used.
Partially that. I think it's also a question of intellectual orientation. Most of those finance ministers are lawyers. The Schwabel in particular has a PhD in law. And this is one thing that goes wrong with the political process. Not that I'm in favor of appointing economists to jobs in economics, obviously, because they're totally delusional, most of them. Yanis, of course, I completely support getting an economics position. But if you're not even trained in the area where your portfolio responsibilities lie, then you are likely to interpret that portfolio using your own intellectual background. And the intellectual background of these people is law. Law involves signing contracts. And from their point of view, Greece is trying to weasel out of a contract. That's entirely the wrong way to think about what's going on there. My suggestion in one of my columns was that maybe the way Yanis should argue is to take a lawyer's point of view and saying part of your contract with us was that if we followed austerity, unemployment would peak at 16%, and by now it would be 12. It's currently 25. You haven't honored the contract. We want to break out of it that way. But, you know, he just simply can't even get to first base in discussing the economic impact of these policies on Greece.
Right. That certainly seems like a tough place. And I totally understand this whole thing about law lawyers and how they think. I got trained in pathology, so everything's risks and probabilities for me. But lawyers are trained to think in a certain way. And our own FOMC is stacked to the gills with people with JD degrees, you know, when it's supposed to be people who represent a cross section of industry and regions and thinking act pretty well stocked with lawyers and academics. as a couple of populations. So about Greece then, though. So Yanis comes in and with Tsipras, and they've got some campaign promises. They come out of the gate, and I was among many who had high hopes that Greece's new government would inject at least some reality into these debt negotiations. It was Yanis who came out and said, "I am the finance minister of a bankrupt country," right? That was just brilliantly honest, something I think we need desperately in today's day. The Troika negotiations saw very little coming out in new terms for Greece. It looks like they're not just on the 11th hour. They're on the 11th hour, 59th minute of this whole thing. They're gutting short on cash. What's going on there right now?
Well, in terms of Greece itself, panic attempts to get money out of the country by people who've got deposits there. Mm-hmm. That's been stalled because of the belief for a while that the crisis would be resolved and they'd stay within the euro. But basically massive uncertainty amongst people. Great support for Syriza, but people worrying that they're going to get steamrolled by the Troika, which they're no longer allowed to call the Troika. I find that quite hilarious. They go through the institutions instead. As if that's that's okay then. When the unemployment rate suddenly falls from 25% to 3%, thanks very much. So the very, I think, trepidatious in Greece itself. Pardon me. A lot of frustration because the Greeks actually don't want to leave the euro. They know that their economy is very weak. They want to be involved with the Europe in general. They don't want to face east, in other words, where it basically means they're aligning themselves with Russia or getting caught up in problems with Turkey and so on. So they've got strong political reasons to want to stay in the euro. And they're trying to find a way to go, what they're calling a bad euro, to a good euro. But the approach of the EU is so strong on maintaining the current terms of the condition that's imposing just the bad euro. And in some, to me, I don't think the European Union appreciates how close there is to a breaking point, because they don't actually provide, the brinkmanship scares me, because if they time it wrong, if they actually get to the point where Greece says we can't pay our debts, and that triggers all sorts of obligations throughout the leveraged world we live in right now, re-rating of debt and so on, it's scary. But the European Union seems to be playing it right to the brink.
Well, it seems to me that the chance for this to break is higher than ever. Mm. I feel the same brinksmanship going on with respect to the way the West and Russia are treating each other at this point in time. So, you know what? When I add all of this up, all of these pressures and tensions, it feels a lot to me like a world that's just ready for another financial accident of some kind. It's got that sense of we've got these sclerotic institutions and ways of thinking. We don't know what to do besides what we've just done. It isn't working, so we do more of it. Mm. And we'll just keep doing that till it breaks. That's my sense. How do you, in your mind, where do we go over the next 5 years in this story?
Well, England and America on an upward trajectory in private borrowing again, America more so than England. And that's what's giving you prosperity, apparent prosperity over there. So that growth trend can continue for some time. I give it about 5 years as a maximum, though, because America's growing from a level of private debt of about 145% of GDP, I think, as the Federal Reserve currently records it. The last big boom, I'd really date for the boom from 1992 forward to 2007, because you only had a little blip during the dot-com bust. The subprime bubble took over where the dot-com bubble gave up, and you had this sort of overlapping period of prosperity going on for 15 years. That simply can't continue this time, because that began from about a 90% private debt to GDP ratio. You're now at 145%, and you reached a peak of 165%. So I give you've got headroom of something like, at best, another 20% of GDP before another private sector catastrophe comes along. People stop borrowing, or there are people who can't manage to roll over their debts and they collapse and cause a financial tidal wave, or banks that end up having, hot potatoes in their books they can't get rid of at the right time, and bang, another crisis. So that's the endogenous, if you like, time limit I'd give it. The other one, which is where the Federal Reserve comes in, is that because the Federal Reserve doesn't comprehend the importance of private debt, because they're seeing growth going on, and not quite certain where it's coming from, but they're applauding that it's happening, they may get into an interest rate rising cycle and not understand the consequences of raising those rates, because again, from their point of view, increasing interest rates simply redistributes income from borrower to lender. So the borrower suddenly gets a more expensive rate, which means they can spend less, but the lender gets a larger amount of cash, which means they can spend more. One cancels the other out, minor microeconomic impact. What they want to do is slow down the rate of growth of the economy by controlling people's desires to invest. That's how they perceive the whole thing. They wouldn't realize that by putting those rates up, they may stop people borrowing from banks, meaning the money creation process suddenly comes to an end and we go down again. So the Federal Reserve can end up pricking this bubble this time round without knowing the bubble's there.
It wouldn't be the first time.
No.
So that's a reasonably safe bet if they're going to create an accident. Maybe that would happen the same way as it happened last time. Well, Steve, thank you so much for your time. And we're out of time here today. I know that you do keep a blog over at Forbes where people could follow you a bit.
That's right. Yep.
Yep. I see that at Forbes.com /sites/Steve Keen. Beyond that, best of luck with working with the people who are trying to bring maybe some view of what we'll call the real world, energy and resources, the environment, all of those other outside things into the world of economics. It's really, honestly, I think one of the biggest things we have to do.
Thank you, Chris. I'm glad to talk to you again. I'm going to catch up again when we're back into America one day.
Absolutely. Thank you, Steve.
Okay, man. Bye-bye.